All right, good afternoon, everyone. How you guys doing? You ready for a wedding? Yeah. All right, good. Hope you're happy. I have one quick announcement before we officially get started. The bride and groom have asked that this be a completely unplugged service for you, not for these wonderful folks taking all the pictures and videography, but please silence your cell phones. Do not take them out and take any pictures during the ceremony. These guys have got it covered. I think they're going to do a great job. They just want a cell phone free service. So will you please honor their wishes? In just a second, we'll be having the grandparents walk in and then followed by the groomsmen and the bride. Thank you.
gathered here today in the presence of God to join Michael Jacobs and Sara Moore in marriage. Marriage is something God created. God created marriage for the welfare and happiness of mankind. God said that a man should leave his father and his mother and be united to his wife. God has also instructed us how marriage is to be lived out. We're to cherish and mutually esteem one another, to love one another, to bear one another's burdens and weaknesses, comfort each other in sickness, trouble, sorrow, and ultimately we're called to lay down our lives, our own wants and desires that our spouse can flourish. None of this can we do in our own strength. The good news is that our Heavenly Father pours out his grace and empowers us to love like he does. That's what we're here for today, so for Michael and Sara to make this promise to one another. So who gives this woman to be married to this man?
We do.
All right, so you may be seated. Let's pray.
The mic now. Okay, we're going to pray. I forgot the mic. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for Michael and Sara. Thank you that you brought us to this day, Lord. And I pray that you'd help each of us here to enjoy it like you'd want us to enjoy it, Lord. Would you come by your Holy Spirit, and would your joy just permeate this room? And I thank you for what we're about to enter into here, Lord. In your name I pray. Amen. Okay, so Michael, will you take this woman to be your wife to live together in the covenant of marriage? Okay. Sara, will you take this man to be your husband to live together in the covenant of marriage? All right. So I'm going to share a little bit here. So every chance I get to share a message at a wedding, I like to talk about covenant. It's something that I think is kind of a churchy word that I don't think our culture really understands or fully appreciates any longer. So I think we've kind of lost the concept of the word. So one of the places in Scripture where we see covenant very clearly portrayed is in Genesis chapter 12, in verses 1 to 3. So I'll just read that real quick. It says, "The Lord said to Abram, 'Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I'll show you, and I will make of you a great nation. I'll bless you and make your name great so that you'll be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. Him who dishonors you, I'll curse. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed.'" So in this passage, there's nothing that Abraham does before this to deserve it. There's nothing he did to earn it. It's just God sovereignly coming to Abraham and saying, I just want to bless you. And what God is doing here with Abraham is making a covenant with him. He's entering into this contract with him and saying, this is what I'm going to do. So I think our culture's messed up consumer and covenant, and I don't think we completely understand the difference. So let me kind of differentiate them for you. When we're in a consumer relationship, there's usually a vendor or someone, they're selling something that we probably want. And so we stay connected to them only as long as they meet our particular needs. So the example that I always use is a grocery store. So you may choose the grocery store that you're going to. You might choose it because it has the best food. You might choose a grocery store because it has the best prices. You might choose it because it has the nicest produce. You might choose it because you can get to it the quickest. And all of that's fine with a grocery store. Those are fine reasons to choose a grocery store. But if a new grocery store comes to town and one of those things are better met by that new grocery store, you're probably going to drop the old one like a bad habit and go to the new grocery store right away. And again, fine to do that with grocery stores, but it's not how we want to be treated as people. In Genesis 1, we see that people are created in God's image, right? And that gives people incredible value and worth. They're not just a good to be consumed, but they're people that we're to love and cherish and lay down our lives for. And we want, every one of us wants people to treat us like covenant. We want them to just love us and like us because we're us, right? So the basic problem is that we often operate by covenant when we should be operating by contract. So I'm borrowing heavily from Timothy Keller's book, Meaning of Marriage, here. He says that a covenant is something far more loving and intimate than a merely legal relationship. It's also far more binding and enduring than a merely emotional relationship. If you're in a consumer relationship, you relate to a vendor, and you have relationship with them as long as they give you your product at a good price. And so when you do that, you're putting your needs before theirs in the relationship, and you're saying, as long as I get the most out of my dollar, I'll stay here. you adjust to me. But in a covenant, you do the opposite. You say, I'll adjust to you. And because I made this promise, my relationship with you is more important than my needs being met. If you get into a relationship and one person's a covenanter and the other person's a consumer, the covenanter will get exploited every time. So an example of this is parents with their young children. They all get exploited by their children. I'll tell you what happened with me and my wife. We had, when our kids were really little, every single one of them, all that we deeply loved them. We couldn't have loved our kids more. But what our kids did, we didn't get a whole lot out of the relationship. When kids are little babies, all they do is they fill diapers up. They sleep all the time. They cry. They have needs. But yet, parents, they're taking care of all these needs. But in that time, parents just couldn't love their child more. And so the parent, they're operating by covenant, and they're loving their child. And the little baby's, like, just kind of sucking the life out of them, right? Like, that's the consumer thing. So what I'm telling you guys is you've got to operate by covenant. You've got to love each other that way and say, I'm going to adjust to you no matter what happens, right? And so as we see, so God, he wants to operate out of covenant with Abraham so much that eventually for this covenant to happen, for this promise to be made, he ends up sending Jesus to earth. And Jesus lives a perfect life. And there's two things I want to pull from Jesus' life. One is that Jesus was willing to die to see the covenant happen. I mean, he died on a cross for our sins. Like, that's something that he did. And so it's not saying, you know, when you get your life straightened out, then I'll covenant with you. It was like, when your life's still a mess, that's when I'm going to make a covenant with you. That's the example that Christ gave us. In Romans, it says that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us, right? And so that's what we're called to do as well. And you know, I've met with you guys. I think you guys are great. But and preparing for this day has been great, but you, like myself, I know that neither of you are perfect, and nobody in this room is perfect. And so I want to challenge you, choose to love each other, even when the other person doesn't deserve it, and I would even say especially when they don't deserve it. When they haven't taken the trash out for the third time in the last month, when they are not doing the dishes, when you want to be listened to and they're not listening to you, when they're putting their clothes on the floor rather than in the hamper, all of that kind of stuff that's going to happen to you in the next couple weeks and months of marriage, choose to love them in the middle of that imperfection. The other thing that Jesus did is he didn't just die, but he resurrected as well. And that resurrection should give you great hope. Number one, it means that he was so committed to his covenant that he raised his son from the dead to fulfill it. It also means the fact that Jesus raised from the dead, it means that our debt toward God is paid in full if we put our trust in him, which I know both of you guys have. And so that's true for you. Your sins have been forgiven. And if your sins are forgiven, that means your spouses are too. And it's out of that great wealth of forgiveness that Christ has shown you that you can now choose to forgive your spouse. So, Michael, you can choose to forgive Sarah when she wrongs you, and Sarah, you can choose to do the same for Michael. The other thing that the resurrection means is it means that there's nothing God can't do, even raising the dead. So you need to remember this in hard seasons of marriage. I think you guys are going to have a great marriage, but I think every marriage, every life, you face hard times. And when you're in those hard times, you need to remember Romans 4:17. It says that God, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence things that don't exist. As you get to know each other more, you're going to find out there's parts of your spouse's life that God hasn't touched yet, that he hasn't, they haven't experienced that resurrection power yet in every area. They're imperfect people. And you need to trust that even those parts of their life, even that past hurt or that past sin, trust that God is so deeply committed to completing that work that he started in your spouse's life the day they decided to follow him. Trust that he's going to bring dead things to life. Pray that he brings dead things to life and watch as he does that. Final thing I wanted to say to you guys. Every wedding I do, I try to pray for the couple and bring them something a little more specific for them. And so as I was praying for you guys, I was reminded of just the story of Peter in the New Testament. Peter's one of Jesus' disciples, and if you remember, he's probably also one of Jesus' closest friends. And Peter, at the end of the Gospels, it doesn't really end the greatest for him. Peter says, you know, Jesus says to him, Peter, you're going to deny me three times. And Peter says, there's no way I'd ever do that. I love you too much. It's so far from me. I would never do that, Lord. And then a couple chapters later, that's exactly what he does. He denies Christ three times. And so it's not a very good ending for Peter. And so as I was thinking about you guys, and I was thinking about me and everybody here, that's kind of our story too, right? Like all of us have done things in the past that we're not, it's not our favorite, and we're not proud of. And so there's things in our past that just we're a little bit ashamed of, and we're not proud of it. They're embarrassing for them. I don't think any of us have ever done anything nearly as bad as Peter denying God, right? Like that, I think that's why God put that in there, so that we can look at Peter and be like, well, yeah, I'm going to be okay. And so anyhow, you get to the book of Acts, right? And it's called the Acts of the Apostles, actually. It's not just Acts. It's called the Acts of the Apostles. And so you get to this book, and if you just read the Gospels, you would expect that Peter would be the last guy to stand up and speak. You'd expect that he'd be too ashamed. He's never going to get up and stand and speak. But when you get to Acts, what you see is actually quite the opposite. In the beginning of the book of Acts, Peter actually ends up being the first dude to get up and talk. Let me find the verse here. In Acts chapter 1, verse 15, Peter's the first one to stand and speak among the brothers. And it's kind of like, what's going on? Like, who do you think you are, Peter, that you're able to get up and talk? And then in chapter 2, there's this mighty rush of wind, and the Holy Spirit comes, and everybody starts speaking in tongues. And then because people start speaking in tongues, it's a Christian thing. Basically what happened, they started speaking in other languages, and everybody in the place was from all different countries, and they all understood what people were saying, and there's no way they should have understood. And so everybody's so confused. What's going on right now? How are we understanding what they're saying? How are they speaking my language? That's what happened. And so there's this huge crowd and this uproar. And again, in chapter 2, Peter is the first one to get up and speak. In verse 14, 2:14, he gets up and he starts addressing them. And then at the end of his speech, in chapter 2, verse 41, he preaches this whole sermon. And then those who received the word were baptized, and they were added that day 3,000 souls. What did Peter understand that he's able to get up and do that? He understood the gospel, right? Like he understood, yeah, I did mess up. I'm not perfect, but you know what? I could never do enough to earn my way to God. But Jesus did. And because of Jesus, I am worthy. I am accepted. And if Jesus, if he came and did everything he said and he put his spirit in me, then there's nothing I can't do. And so for you guys, that truth is what I want you to hold on to. Forget about your past. Like, you guys have the Holy Spirit living in each of you. And because the Holy Spirit's in you, there's nothing you can't do. And so I think that you're going to see some stuff like this happen in your life as well. I think you're going to share the gospel with people, and they're going to come to know Jesus, and there's going to be just amazing fruit from your life. When you look back 10 years, 20 years from now, I think there's going to be amazing fruit from your marriage. Continue to run after Jesus. Continue to run after each other. And if you do that, you're going to see great fruit. So, the next thing that these two would like to do is they want to tie a unity knot. So this is based on Ecclesiastes chapter 4, and it's in verse 12. So this is verse 12. Here's what it says. It says, though a man might prevail against one who's alone, two will withstand him. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. And so this is Michael and Sara. They just want to say that they can't do this on their own. They want Jesus to be a part of their life. And that third strand in the cord is representing Jesus. And they want to be intertwined with him. Okay? All right, guys, we're at the exchange of vows now, all right? All right, so Michael, I need you to repeat after me, okay? I, Michael, take you, Sarah.
I, Michael, take you, Sarah.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
I will love, honor, and cherish you.
I will love, honor, and cherish you.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and health.
In sickness and health.
Forsaking all others.
Forsaking all others.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
I will be faithful to you.
I will be faithful to you.
And honest with you.
And honest with you.
I'll protect you.
I will protect you.
Care for you.
Care for you.
And pray for you.
And pray for you.
As God directs in his holy word.
As God directs in his holy word.
All this I do promise.
All this I do promise.
Before God and these witnesses. Okay, Sarah. I, Sarah, take you, Michael, to be my wedded husband. I will love, honor, and cherish you for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and health, forsaking all others, as long as we both shall live. I will be faithful to you, honest with you. I will respect you, care for you, and pray for you. As God directs in his holy word, all this I do promise before God and these witnesses. Okay, so it's the pattern of Noah, or of God, to mark his covenants with his people with a sign. With Noah, he says the rainbow is a sign. God does this for our good. We're forgetful people. Even when we don't forget that something has happened, we often forget the significance of an event. By wearing a wedding ring, we're following in God's pattern of bearing a sign of the covenants that we make. This is why even after Jesus Christ was raised from the dead and his body was healed, the circled scars upon his wrist were not. Our ring serves as a reminder of our vow to love our spouse according to the pattern and in response to Christ's love for us. So, Michael, what token do you offer that you'll faithfully fulfill the vows you've just taken?
Ring.
Okay, will you repeat after me? With this ring,
I thee wed,
I give it to you as a symbol of my love.
I give it to you as a symbol of my love.
Okay, Sarah, what token do you offer that you'll faithfully fulfill the pledge that you have just taken? So, as you place the ring on his finger, repeat after me. With this ring, I thee wed, I give it to you as a symbol of my love. You getting it on? All right. Okay, so for the final step here, I'm going to ask Pastor Joel Gilman to come up and do the honors. He's ready. Just make him wait a little more.
It is with great pleasure that by the authority committed to me as a minister of the gospel, and in the name of the Father, the Son, Jesus, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, I now pronounce Michael and Sarah husband and wife, according to the word of God and the law of Pennsylvania, whom therefore God has joined together, let no man separate. Michael, you may kiss your bride. Ladies and gentlemen, for the first time, I present to you Mr. and Mrs. Jacobs.
Okay, so if you all could just wait for a second, we're going to take a quick picture up here, okay?
Da, 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 da.
Like a fool, I went and stayed too long.
Ba-dum.
Now I'm wondering if your love's still strong.
Ooh, baby, here I am, signed, sealed, delivered, I'm yours. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Ba-dum.
Then that time I went and said goodbye.
Ba-dum.
Now I'm back and not ashamed.
Here I am,
baby. Oh,
silence,
I'm
here.
Here I am.
to the back. We're going to dismiss front to back. Some of the family needs to stay in here for pictures, okay? The rest of you, there should be some bubbles just on the other side of that wall. And in a little bit, the bride and groom, he's holding them back there. The bride and groom are going to come out, and we're going to blow bubbles at them as they head out. The reception will be at the Blue Heron in Greencastle. We look forward to seeing you all there, okay?